Too proper for the black kids, too black for the Mexicans, too square to be a hood nigga. What's normal anyway? That's a nice way of setting up pretty much my life experience.
Miguel, he's not your average R&B star. He's not your average rock star. And he's definitely not average at anything. You've probably listened to him in the nude. He's seductive, he's smooth, he's sexy. In the late 2000s, his label wanted him to be the next Mario, or the next Usher. But he wanted to be, well, the next Miguel. I sat down with him moments before his gig at the Enmore Theatre.
Thank you so much for joining me, man.
Man, it's a pleasure, Marty. Yeah. Thanks for having me.
You as an artist emerged out of a period of R&B that reached its commercial peak, and then you were kind of being molded into this artist that you didn't think you were necessarily. What did you discover you weren't during that time?
As far as discovery goes, I've always known that I was something else. You know, I think I was going, how can I fit me into this thing that you expect so that you listen? And I think after that experience, I was like, oh, I don't have to be in that box. I can just be other.
You could retire the sunglasses,
the red sunglasses. I still love those sunglasses. I don't care.
Really?
Yeah, I still love them. I don't look back and go, why did I wear those? Yeah. I'm like, I know who I was at the time. I know why. I get it.
There's a fine line between a corny, seductive song and a truly sexy, seductive track. What do you think it takes to write that kind of song?
Vulnerability.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I think that's vulnerability is probably the most seductive thing as a human being.
Do you think it's crazy that you probably allow a lot of men to get vulnerable in the bedroom?
Yeah, I actually pride myself on being that dude, you know? I think in all my favorite songs, there's just that thing that you feel like they really just, you know, are bearing it all, or saying something that just took some courage. Great songs give us that extra courage that we need, you know? It just makes us feel alive, and that's what it's all about. Sin ti, que me puede
importar, si lo que me hace llorar. You've also been reconnecting with your cultural past by going to Mexico with your father and your brother. Did you find out something about yourself that you didn't already know during that trip? Did you feel a shift?
Taking a trip to Mexico really changed a lot for me, and not so much in anything I didn't know about myself. It was probably more about how deep my gratitude is for the opportunity that I have to do what I love now. Because I am Mexican and black, my father's Mexican, he's from Zamora, Michoacan in Mexico, and my mother is a beautiful black woman from Inglewood, California. So they met in Inglewood and in Los Angeles growing up in the 90s. There's a lot of tension, racial tension between blacks and Mexicans.
They talk about this is a black school, this is a black city, this is a black neighborhood. It's not fair, we're Hispanics, we have a right to say whatever we want.
They started calling us names like nigga and everything like that. And so we started fighting.
Trying to figure out where I belong and how to belong or who I was has been a journey. It's been a real journey, and I think that's why my music sounds the way that it does. You know, it's diverse because I'm diverse, and I've learned to embrace that.
Don't stop. All right. Yeah.
Was there a particular moment where you felt more content with yourself?
I think the overall trip, leaving the trip, I just felt more rooted. And I think that feeling of contentment just comes from appreciating, again, like that place of gratitude where I'm like, wow, you know, if my grandmother would have never left and never met my grandfather and decided to settle down and then, you know, had children and having my father and leaving my father and all of her children and my grandfather to go work to hopefully bring them up and then eventually being able to do that and them coming to Inglewood, California, where my father eventually went to school and eventually went to high school where he met my mother in high school. I would have never even existed, you know? And it's a culmination of a lot of these like small decisions that bring Miguel to Australia in 2018.
It's been so long since I see you.
What do you think is the best love-making song ever written?
Best love-making song? There's so many. I mean, you can definitely go, you know, sexual healing is always going to be a great one.
I'm happy with like a Destiny's Child Cater to You.
Okay, yeah. Nice, all right.
Like I know it's a feminine track.
Yeah.
But yeah. I quite like it.
I'm not mad at that.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, I'm not mad at that.
Do you have a personal favorite?
For sex, like, there's too many.
An easy go-to.
I mean, Closer is a go-to. I'm being real. That is a go-to for me. That's all the primal and spiritual. That's where that kind of all meets for me, you know? But there's so many, man. There's a lot.
That's probably a good place to leave it.
Yeah.
Thank you very much,
man. Yeah, man. Thank you.
Cheers.
Appreciate you.